What we're going to do now is move to our next speaker, who is Dr. Ben Strauss with Climate Central. Ben's topic is on sea level rise, and Climate Central and Ben have really done a lot of work to help visualize impacts of sea level rise, and we'll jump right into it with Ben so he can enlighten us with some of his visualizations and some of the research they've been doing. So Ben, thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Dave. Thanks again to Jim. That was a terrific talk, and it's going to be a hard act to follow. But what I'm going to try and do in this talk is basically show you where does all that ice, when it melts, go? What does that look like for American communities? And give you some pictures and to show that, some tools to explore what that means in different communities across the United States. I also wanted to, before I start my plan talk, pick up where on one thing Jim said that I think is such an important message. It's really the core of this and the big question that we're all really kind of dying to know and focused on. Speed kills, right? The speed of change is the real variable that we need to be focused on here. And just a couple of illustrations I like to use. You know, a bullet that I'm holding in my hand or that I throw across the room is not very dangerous. Or, you know, my first apartment after college, a 5-story walk-up. So when I had to go down, I would take the stairs down. Not very dangerous. If you jump out the window, totally different story. So speed of change is really the absolutely critical variable that we need to look at. So I'm going to talk through a number of different time frames and kind of sensitive to the nature of TV and broad audiences. I'm going to start with the present and the kinds of challenges that sea level rise caused by humans is already causing because there are stories to tell about the present. Then we'll get into the coming few decades, and then I'll talk more about the long-term legacy that we're leaving and the choices that we have in the different legacies that we could leave. So beginning with today, I just thought I'd start with a little bit of background on sea level rise and its causes, and Jim did some of this for me, so I'm going to get to zip through some slides a bit more quickly than I was planning. But if you look over the last few decades, about 40% of sea level rise has come from what we call thermal expansion of the ocean. And here's just a look at, there's actually some interesting spatial variation of that. Here's a look at 50 years of warming and sea surface temperatures. About 30% has come from melting mountain glaciers, small glaciers, in the last century. Not much, well, there's another meter plus left from, maybe a little more than that from glaciers left, but not a ton. About 20% from melting ice sheets in Greenland and Antarctica. The numbers behind this graphic have been updated a little by the science that happened since we put this together about 5 years ago, but I really love the graphic to illustrate the acceleration in ice loss that we're seeing from Greenland, and that was also evident in Jim's slides. But if you step out for a wider picture and look at kind of all of the major ice sheet areas, you can see that West Antarctica is also in some decline, and that's really the sleeping giant that I think we're most worried about in terms of the potential for rapid sea level rise, even this century, second half of this century. There are some possibilities there. All right, so a nice thing about sea level as a way to communicate about climate change broadly is it's one of the easiest and most intuitive things to measure. I mean, you literally, this is a almost 100-year record from a tide gauge in Boston. And tide gauges are basically sticks in the ground, and we watch the water come up. It's hard to dispute these long records of sea level rise. Moving south, here's 100 years in Key West. These rates vary a little bit from place to place for reasons I'll get into. Here's about 150 years in New York, a little bit faster than each of those. And all told, we've got a lot of tide gauges around the world that have helped us to understand sea level change over the last decades, century, a little bit more. This is just a subset of them, but these are some of the gauges with longer records, at least several decades. And here's the record that comes out of that, just through around 2000, tide gauge-based record, and then I'll continue showing a satellite-based record since the early 1990s with that faster rate of change, more than 3 millimeters per year, whereas last century we were seeing less than 2 millimeters per year from the tide gauge record. And here's another kind of different kind of visual evidence of sea level rise. The dead trees you see here are what we call a ghost forest. This happens to be on the Bass River in New Jersey. Those are trees that have died because the water has become too salty. So here's evidence just in the last several decades of sea level rising locally, and you can see it right there in the landscape. Here's another shot looking sideways at another part of the Bass River. And another thing that's interesting about this environment is you see the salt marsh in the foreground, and so that's one of the main pathways we have into understanding sea level over the last couple thousand years. Geoscientists can dig transects of sediment cores in salt marshes and see what the elevation of salt marshes were at different periods, and they can see that elevation increase or decrease in different periods of time. And when you do that analysis, looking at salt marsh cores and other proxies for past sea levels over the past couple thousand years, you get a record that looks like this. These are sea level changes, global sea level changes, by century over the last 20 centuries, and you can see that the 20th century really, really sticks out. This figure, which we put together, and one of the things I'd like to do in this paper, most of you, if not all of you, know that at Climate Central, one of the things we do is provide kind of graphical material that is kind of based in the peer-reviewed science, but designed to be very accessible for a broad audience, and we make it available for you to use. So I'll be sharing some sea level related examples of that kind of material in this talk, and we love for you to use them in social media, on the air, in talks, wherever it's valuable, where it can be a valuable tool. So we made this figure based on this paper published a year ago, I think a very important paper, which did establish that huge spike of the last century and how different it was than the previous several millennia. And the second thing that it did, besides showing this kind of unprecedented sea level rise in the last century compared to the last, the history of human civilization, is it put a number on the human contribution to sea level, right? How we've seen sea level rising, we know the planet's warming, we have lots of reasons to believe that the sea level is rising because of us, but there's also natural variability in the system, and so there's a need to assess just how much of the sea level rise we're seeing is because of us. It could be the total amount, it could be less than the total because there could be a natural background increase in sea level that should be happening right now, and in fact, the sea level attributable to us could be greater than the sea level we're observing, if naturally sea level should be declining, right? So this paper put a number, a range of numbers, on human-caused sea level rise. And when I was lucky to run into the lead author at a meeting about a month before this paper published, and we agreed to collaborate on a companion report that we published at Climate Central and that Bob co-authored with us, which took his time series of human-caused sea level rise to construct a new history of flooding at tide gauges around the United States. So I just showed you those tide gauge records. We have hourly water level readings from tide gauges around the United States that stretch back many decades, half a century in many cases. So what we did was we said, in the real world, what we actually observed was, we took 27 tide gauges and we said, there were X number of floods over the last 50 years. And we can identify each one, the date, in the actual observed tide gauge record. Now, let's create another record, a record where we subtract out this human-caused sea level rise component. How many floods would there have been without human-caused sea level rise? Or, to put it another way, how many floods did we cause? And we assessed what a flood is by using the National Weather Service local definition at these 27 tide gauges. The National Weather Service definition for a minor flood, right? They do that in a locality based on their observations of when roads begin to flood, sewers begin to back up. There's a problem. There's some infrastructure issue. So we simply counted how many floods there actually happened and how many floods would have happened if we took out the human fingerprint. And here's an example of what we found for Boston. In orange, you see the human-driven floods. So it's actually the majority, and an increasing majority, since 1955, right? We're looking across six decades here. And give you a little tour. Here's Kings Point, New York. It's in Brooklyn. Little smaller fraction of effect. Here's a look at Atlantic City in New Jersey. Here's a look at Annapolis. This looks different because I'm actually excerpting this from a big sea level and coastal flood tool that I'm going to show you later. But I took this one just to highlight this lower part of the tool. The bar graph on the top is the same as what you've seen, except the orange is on top instead of below. Annapolis has a really big coastal flood problem. Most of these graphs, you'll notice that the change is really exponential, the increase in floods and the increase in human-driven floods. But I just want to let you know that in the tool that I'm going to show you later, we actually have built an automated system where, I got an alert this morning that floods are forecasted about 7 of our gauges around the U.S. in the next 48 hours, and we observed floods at several gauges in the last 24 hours, and so we pipe that into this tool, so it's just a way. If anyone's interested, we can hook you up with automated updates of when a flood is coming or when a flood has just happened, if your market happens to be one of our 27 tide gauges.
Yeah. Dr. Strauss, Howard Bernstein, WSA Washington.
Yeah.
I was looking at something about nuisance flooding, and it showed that Baltimore, Annapolis, D.C.,
yeah,
we're amongst the top 10 in the last 50 years of doing this, and some of the increases were in the 500-900% range. What is so special about the Chesapeake region that, yeah, we've seen, these nuisance flooding increases and these advisories from the Weather Service much more than maybe other parts?
Yeah. So the rate of increase has to do with a couple of different things. One is the rate of sea level rise, and that can vary locally. But another is, how shall I say, the higher the flood, the rarer it is. And the lower the flood, the lower the water level, the more common it is. And there's a curve. And that curve kind of, different places have different shapes to that curve. So some places, as you go from a low water event to a high water event, the frequency may change gradually. But in other places, there may be a rather sharp break. And so in some places, a very small change in sea level can lead to
Is it the shape of the coast or the sub-areas that have anything to do with that?
Well, I would say the storm climatology, the storm surge climatology. So imagine, let's put it this way. Imagine you're in a place, there are some places where there's a very small difference between the height of a one-year flood, an annual event, and a 100-year flood. So in the San Francisco Bay Area, for example, where it's very protected, you don't have tropical cyclones. I think it's less than a foot of difference there, between a one-year event and a 100-year event. And in a place like that, a 1 foot of sea level rise would make a huge difference. You'd be seeing all of the time events that had never been seen before. Now, in a place like Louisiana, where the difference between a one-year event and a 100-year event might be 5-10 feet, then 1 foot of sea level rise makes much less of a difference in terms of the frequency of flooding. So that has an impact. And so the suggestion is these places that have a really sharp uptick, there's a less space between the 1 year and the 100-year. It's not exactly that. It also, frankly, has a little bit to do with just what is the elevation, you know, what is the threshold that the National Weather Service set, you know, how is the city built? And that affects what the threshold is with a flood that poses a nuisance. And if there's a high density, you know, if your threshold is 1 meter, and right, and a 1 meter flood is pretty low frequency historically, but it just so happens that a 90 centimeter flood, I should be talking in feet and inches, a 90 centimeter flood is very frequent, then a small change in sea level can lead to a huge change in your flood frequency.
And just one last point, like in South Florida, where John Morales is, they have their king tides and flooding there. Those thresholds from the Weather Service offices, they vary around the country depending on the local conditions?
Yes, completely different levels depending on local conditions. Really, you know, the relationship of the built environment to the local water level.
Jim Gandy, WLTX in Columbia, South Carolina. Could you give us a feeling for what is included in this natural variability? What naturally would cause some of these flooding events?
Yeah, so two things. One, there's a natural component to local sea level rise in most places in the United States, which is sinking land. So we didn't include that portion of sea level rise in the orange, but we do include it in the blue. So we expect the blue bars to increase in most places. Like in Annapolis, there's certainly sinking land, and that's probably the main reason you see the increase in the blue bars. Second, there is natural, you know, a stormier decade, a less stormy decade. And this analysis does not take into account any possible change in storm climatology linked to climate change. So actually, if there are more floods because you're just getting bigger nor'easters or because of a shift in Atlantic circulation that's led to higher sea levels on the east coast of the United States, as we've seen this last decade, that's not included. That's kind of short-term variability. Here's a look at DC. All this stuff is on our website. Wilmington, North Carolina, has a really big problem, partly caused by dredging in the shipping channels there. And that's some of the increase in the blue here. Charleston, Key West. I thought John was going to be here, so here's a cameo. See, you all can do this. It's really useful stuff. San Francisco, Seattle, you get the idea. Here's the United States all added up together, the 27 tide gauges. So it's a really strong signal. And in fact, over this whole period, since the mid-1950s, 2 out of 3 coastal floods were driven by human-caused sea level rise in our analysis, which to me, you know, when we have a flood, and the Sandy flood was obviously not tipped over the balance by the few inches of human-caused sea level rise, but the vast majority of floods are really small. They're just over that nuisance threshold, and that's the kind of flood that gets in the way of your commute, you know, that puts salt in your lawn. So the vast majority of what people are dealing with in their daily lives, it's actually driven by us. And so, you know, we see those floods and we think it's the tide, you know, the wind was blowing in the wrong direction, and that was the proximate cause, but it would not have tipped that flood threshold without sea level rise from us. And I think that just underscores, like, we need a fundamental shift in our thinking and storytelling, I think, to help get this across. It's a different picture. It's a different way of thinking. And if you look, so this popped up on my web alerts a couple days after. So it's this near-term stuff really, I mean, in the work we do, like, it drew a lot of attention. And that won't surprise you. But obviously, the news you can use, the kind of present tense, like, we had no contact with Senator Whitehouse's office, and then suddenly we have this alert. I mean, this research, both the paper I showed and our report, were covered very prominently by the Times, and that's probably how it got to Whitehouse. But this stuff is out there as a kind of significant news item. Kind of going back to the trend, if you focus in on the last decade, I just told you 2 out of 3, but in our analysis in the last decade, it's up to 3 out of 4 flood events were really driven by human-caused sea level rise. And just to show a few more graphics we have around this, there. Kind of geographic distribution. There's 74% because we're leaving out the Pacific ones in this graphic. So now I'm going to talk about tomorrow, a little bit of a longer time frame, but I'll wrap it up. And this is probably, it's harder to get our heads around and it's harder to engage audiences on, but I'm going to wrap up this part with, you know, a good reason why this particular the forecast, the meteorology community, I think, has a really big role to play here in driving across the significance of thinking in terms of really focusing on what's happening in a decade scale, not just today and tomorrow. You know, today and tomorrow. So, for me as a scientist, tomorrow includes the next several decades or this century.
Before we head to tomorrow, and I came in late, so I had to double check that you didn't cover this first thing. I am Joe Murgo from WTAJ-TV. I believe I still am. But anyway, what is the algorithm to be sure what part is the man and what part is the natural? Yeah. I guess, I mean, we're showing that, but you really didn't tell me how you came apart with that number.
So we took the central best estimate from the Kopp et al. Paper published in the Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences for a global contribution, for the attributable human-caused part of global sea level rise over the last century. So he has a range of estimates, low to high range, but we took the central estimate kind of year by year. So it's, you know, 4 inches, 5 inches, 6 inches in different years. And we subtracted that from the tide gauge records at each local tide gauge. So there's a little bit of an assumption here that we can subtract out the global human-caused sea level rise from, like, the local record in New York and kind of then tell a story about what was human-caused in New York. But we feel comfortable with that because there are a lot of reasons to believe that the human signal is, in fact, larger than the global average on the East Coast of the United States, maybe not on the West Coast, but on the East Coast. As you saw, I had an early slide that showed that there's been above average sea surface temperature warming in the East Coast, and also we've had a slowing down of the Atlantic meridional overturning circulation, which also contributes to higher seas in the East Coast. And both of those things have likely climate links.
Okay,
so we're probably lowballing it.
There is still a bit of an assumption on each one. And the reason why I'm asking is when I go back to my viewers and I show something like that, it's hard to explain something that has some vagueness to it.
Yeah.
I mean, just to be honest.
Yeah. Well, I would say, look, we took the record, what we actually saw, the water levels hour by hour that were observed and counted the floods, and then we subtracted out the part of global sea level rise caused by humans. And we counted the floods there. And that's what we did. And that's It's two sentences. It's very transparent. You know, some people might want to push and pull, like, well, okay, like, is it fair to take out the global part? And if you want to have that argument, like, I think there's a strong case to be made that's lowballing it. But yeah, I mean, in all of science, there's communication, you have this challenge, right? We're all presenting a simplified story and trying to do it in the most rigorous and honest way possible. But when, you know, when you have only a few seconds, a few moments to explain it, it's hard to pull out all the nuance. All right, so now let's turn from the sea level record to sea level projections. And there are actually tons of studies out there. I'm showing a figure from the National Climate Assessment, the US National Climate Assessment, published in 2014. And I'm showing this because that's a good authoritative source, and also the projections that I'm going to have. The projections I happen to be using in the slides that I'm about to show you, although you can choose other projections to look at. I will say most of what I'm going to show you is using the 4 foot by 2100 assumption here, scenario. And I will show some that go up to 6.6 feet. At this point, the 1 foot is really not a credible, plausible estimate. I would say the low ball would be 2 feet, not 1 foot. 4 feet is in the vicinity of the kind of conservative 1 meter, 3.3 feet, right, that Jim was talking about. And 6.6 feet was chosen by the National Climate Assessment really as the plausible upper limit of what's possible. But the science has changed since then, and 6.6 feet is now looking like a very, not the upper limit of what's possible, but a very plausible upper scenario if West Antarctica starts to go quickly, when you incorporate things like that ice cliff collapse mechanism that Jim was talking about. You can easily get to 1 meter from West Antarctica this century, added on to the 1 meter from everything else. Because the 4 foot scenario here, the 1 meter scenarios basically include nothing from Antarctica. But of course, as we were just discussing, sea level rise in a local market, in a local place, is different than global sea level rise. And that's true for a number of different reasons. One is actually because land is rising and sinking in different places, really as an echo from the last ice age. The yellow, orange, and red tones on this map show land that is sinking. So the darker red, the faster the sinking, which means that you observe faster sea level rise. You'll see that globally, you know, the United States pretty much lost the lottery on this particular component of sea level rise, as we're almost completely in the red here. We used to have this massive ice sheet pressing down on Canada that extended as far as Long Island. Long Island is the terminal moraine of that ice sheet. So the land that used to be under that ice sheet was compacted and compressed by the weight of the ice sheet. And when the ice sheet retreated, you know, that land is rebounding up, and that's why Canada is blue. But if you think of a mattress now, think of the Earth as a mattress. If I sit down on that mattress, the part underneath me, in fact, compresses just like Canada did. And when I get up, it comes back up. But if you think of a mattress, and I sit down on that mattress, the part not underneath me but near me, away, kind of away from me, that goes up like a lever. And when I get up, it sinks back down a little. And that sinking back down a little is what's happening in the dark red, right, of the United States. So we have that factor, which affects local sea level rates. And the projections I'm going to show you, kind of place by place, take that into account. They're all localized. We've gone beyond the global projections. And also, the sea surface itself, it's the actual physical rise of water does vary from place to place. This map illustrates some of that variation in the satellite era of the last 23 years. And kind of in this case, you know, in the United States, we're around average in the Gulf and Atlantic coasts, and a little below average on the Pacific coast. And we also take those accounts, those differences into account in the projections I'm going to show you. So now I'm going to spend a fair amount of time showing off this tool that we've built called Risk Finder, the Surging Seas Risk Finder. And I'm going to use it to show sea level rise impacts and threats in different places around the US, to tell a number of stories, different stories in different places, and just, I hope, suggest that there are many more stories to be found and told. We worked very hard to try and make this as accessible as possible, for example, with the Google-like interface here, where you can literally type in a zip code and get a page for that zip code, or a city, or a county, or a state, and get analysis for the corresponding place. So at the start, I'm just going to quickly take you through all the parts of the tool without going into any detail, and then I'm going to go back and go through each part more slowly to tell different stories in different places. If you type New York City, you would land on this page, and then a series of further slides will show what you see when you scroll down. But the point is, there's just one page for New York City, and all you have to do is scroll and kind of tweedle with the knobs. You have your map, you have different various reports related to New York. Next, scrolling panel, what are projections, when are the risks coming for a particular sea level. We've already seen, you know, how are coastal floods already increasing in that area. What are some of the things at risk? Here, a look at population living on vulnerable land, or a map of the same kind of thing. And finally, resources that communities can use to prepare themselves and learn more about local efforts to address the coming threat. So back to the start. I'll start with a story about New York. I've chosen 6 feet above mean high or high water on the water level slider here, just because that's just about as high as you need to get to flood the subway system. Sandy got to 9 feet. But actually, there's been no flood in our historic record that topped 6 feet, except for Sandy. So 6 feet is still, it's a very significant level for New York. Here we are on the summary page. And you'll notice there's a local fact sheet. And for people who like something in their hand, every city, every zip code, we have a kind of custom-generated one sheet that you can print out. And if you're at a venue where you're speaking to people, like, this is a great summary of kind of basic science around sea level, local issues, local threats, projections, and impacts. And then let's look at the timeline of risk. Now, here, we're looking not at a sea level rise projection, but at what we call a multi-year risk of flooding. And that's what I think people really want to know. Not sea level will rise 2 feet in 60 years. They want to know, what's the chance that my property gets flooded over my mortgage, over the next 30 years, right? So this particular way of looking, we integrate sea level rise projections here, but we're saying, what's the risk of at least one flood topping 6 feet in this area between today and 2020, 2030, you know, and different decades to come? And of course, part of the reason that the risk increases over time is that there are just simply more years when a flood might happen. We can play with the water level and see, of course, the risk is lower for an 8-foot flood, closer to Sandy's level. Let's come back down to 6. You can see that this is a medium sea level rise projection. That's the 4-foot scenario I showed before. If we have a fast sea level rise scenario from the National Climate Assessment, the risk increases. If you want, you can click on advanced and get into all kinds of different models. This is people who want to geek out, you can. Over time, we're going to continue to add models here, right, as important new sea level rise projections are published. But back to the basic model. Here's the multi-year risk at 6 feet, and here's the single-year risk. So that's kind of interesting. It's a lot lower, and then it eventually climbs rather steeply. And here's the projected sea level rise that corresponds with that
curve. And one thing that's interesting to note is you have this much more gradual increase in sea level, excuse me, right? But that can lead to a steeper increase in flood risk, which is what we really, that's what we experience. All right, just a quick note to assure you. So all those charts I just showed are based on this and other papers. This is a paper published by a colleague with myself and another colleague at NOAA. So everything that I'm showing you today is kind of grounded in the peer-reviewed literature. Now I'm going to turn to maps, which are based on very accurate LIDAR elevation data from these laser rangefinder overflights compiled for coastal areas by NOAA, and also on NOAA data for local tide levels. So these are this chart shows variation essentially in the average high tide line around the U.S. So all of our analysis is keyed, in fact, to mean higher high water, not just mean high water. It makes no sense to key our maps to pure elevation because, you know, what does 5 feet mean if your high tide is at 2 feet in one part of the country and 4 feet in another part of the country? Everything is keyed to the local high tide. All right, so let's look at the maps part of this. Here's New York. The blue is flooded area, more precisely, that's below, that's less than 6 feet above the local high tide line. We can zoom in a lot. We can reveal landmarks here in colored dots, and if we zoom closer, we reveal the icons for hospitals or schools and the like. We zoom closer and get the names of those facilities, so you can really get into a great deal of granularity. The green areas are low-lying, but isolated. They're not connected to the water. It's like a depression that's farther inland. Still relevant to show because if the sea level rose this much or if there were a high flood and it were raining, right, like the water couldn't easily drain. Also, you know, the elevation data still aren't perfect, so there's some possibility of some kind of connection between the areas that appear disconnected or connected. Well, you know, so what we're showing here is water level. And in a way, this is a glorified elevation map. And the water could get this high in a whole lot of different ways. You know, we could wait 100 years and sea level could rise 6 feet. And then the blue would be inundated at your average high. You know, every day there are two high tides. So it would be inundated at the average higher of those two high tides. Or there might be a horrible nor'easter that happens in 2 weeks, and you could get the same water level. So it's just an elevation reference. And we also can intersect these at-risk areas with beyond landmarks with things like population. Here's population density per square mile in this part of the Lower East Side. So if we can overlay landmarks and population against the map, clearly we can also calculate how many people are at risk in these vulnerable areas. So here in New York, for example, here's a table. More than 200,000 people in New York City live less than 6 feet above the local high tide. Of course, they may be in tall apartments, but the base of the building at least is there. We can map it. Here by individual neighborhood, that's broken out. This is not the next slide. You see the pattern change a little. This is a population with a high level of social vulnerability, kind of lower, for example, communities with lower income levels. And so they have a kind of double jeopardy between the physical threat and their own social vulnerability. And all of those assessments are kind of grounded in the methods we lay out in this paper. Final panel of the tool, I already talked about different resources, local resources. All right, so now I'm going to do a little tour around the country and show different little subsets of the tool to tell different stories. Moving to South Florida, here's something really interesting. So we're looking at just 2 feet above mean high or high water. And by the way, this fall's king tides didn't quite reach 2 feet for a frame of reference for our South Florida people. They were maybe an inch shy. So 2 feet is a pretty rare and special event still in South Florida. Obviously, you can get something huge with a hurricane, but the normal climatology outside of tropical cyclones is very, very mild. There's not a lot of water level variation. It's king tides. So here's the single year risk of flooding above 2 feet. And what I want to draw your attention to is that we're around 10% in 2030 in this particular projection, annual risk. That would mean you would expect a flood that high about once per decade. 2 decades later, you're above 80%, meaning you're flooding almost every year. So you could buy a property and get a 30-year mortgage, and when you buy the property, maybe it's never flooded or it flooded once in the last 10 years, and before you're done with that mortgage, it's flooding every year. So this sharp 2 to 3 decade transition in flood risk across a particular threshold, I think is really close to the heart of what people are going to see and feel and is going to move them in the near term. If we move to a fast rise scenario, that 2 decade period shifts forward a decade. But I actually see this in a lot of markets around the United States, this relatively sharp transition. It's usually more like 3 decades, in some places 4. But a 2 to 4 decade transition, which is around the period of a mortgage, where you go from extremely rare flood to almost every year. And I think that's a great concern. And here's a look at Miami Beach, places less than 2 feet above mean high or high water. So it's not the end of Miami Beach, but that's a lot of territory. And here we're overlaying it with property value density. So the dark red is over $100 million per square mile. Miami Beach is investing, by the way, $400 million right now in a campaign to rise above, a branded campaign rising above, raising streets, putting in pumps. Most communities don't have the resources that Miami Beach has. They're self-taxing to do that. And there's no way that states and federal resources are going to be able to rescue communities at that level of expense. That $400 million, that's inches into a problem that's going to be measured in feet. So here's $6.6 billion of property on land less than 2 feet in Miami-Dade County in our analysis. So we don't have to get to the big hurricane storm surge. Here's a map by zip code in Miami-Dade of the distribution of that property value. And here's a map by county in Florida. Monroe County has much lower value real estate, but has a bigger threat from 2 feet. All right, moving to DC. All the way up at 8 feet, DC gets higher water levels. Because the tide gauge that we're analyzing here is on the Potomac, so there's a river flood influence in it. But we'll just look at a couple maps of 8 feet. This is interesting because of just the cultural value of the things at risk, as well as the national value. In this map in the southeast, there are the Washington Naval Yards. The Jefferson Memorial is in blue here. And the kind of isolated green part is, runs through the mall. And interestingly, what you're seeing is an old channel of the Potomac there, right? That is cut off. But the DC government is actually already building, they've built and they're continuing to work on some levees to protect that area. All right, and here's a look at wastewater sites below 8 feet in DC. When Sandy hit New York City, did a really good job of taking its wastewater treatment plants offline and hardening them and protecting them so that they were not damaged by Sandy. And once the danger had passed, they came back online, and there really wasn't a raw sewage issue. But in Westchester, Long Island, Connecticut, New Jersey, it was a different story, and you know, many millions of gallons of raw sewage ended up getting into the water because of the damage to those plants. Yeah.
If anybody's wondering about the accuracy of those projections during Hurricane Isabel, and I don't know how high we got, but many of those areas that you highlighted in the 8 feet around the tidal basin, and around the mid, they did go underwater by quite a bit.
Yeah. Thank you. So you know, you don't want raw sewage kind of coming, right? So we're mapping a lot of infrastructure here in this analysis. There are a lot of stories to tell. Moving to North Carolina, I mentioned, you know, Wilmington is really one of the places in the country that's having the biggest problems with nuisance flooding, and in our analysis, a very large fraction human-caused. But North Carolina is also a state of barrier islands, and I want to show you this little diagram to illustrate, I think, a very widespread misperception about the threat of flooding and sea level rise. Here's a cross-section of a barrier island, and on the right is the beach. And you'll notice the slope of the beach is relatively steep. And then on the backside, the bayside, it's a gentle slope. And if you look, there's actually a lot more land on the bayside that's very low and flat. So that's the side that has the real risk from flooding. The beach can get the big waves and the camera drama, right, of the house falling over because it got smashed by the waves. But in terms of like the hundreds of homes that can flood, like the mass of people whose lives can be upended by flooding, they live on the bayside. And they might have bought those properties thinking that they were protected from all the drama, that the danger was on the beach. But there's a huge danger on the bayside, and I think people don't understand that. And these maps will illustrate this. Here's the current coast near Nag's Head, and now let's look at 4 feet. And you can see that all of the blue shading, first of all, on the barrier island, it's on the bayside. And then, of course, in all of this protected area behind the barrier islands, you've got large expanses of very flat land because it didn't have the wave action to build up the beach slope. So it's an error and an illusion if we think we're protected by living by the bay and not on the beach. This is really, it's a problem that goes inland. Another kind of theme for North Carolina, it has in the nation by far the most miles of threatened roads. All those roads connecting the island, connecting the barrier islands and in coastal counties, hundreds and hundreds of miles of roads to deal with. And I used to think that a little salt water above a road wasn't a problem, right? It comes and it goes. But I've learned from transportation engineers that, in fact, it corrodes the whatever's under the road and the asphalt itself corrode more rapidly. You have requirement for more maintenance by simple saltwater floods over roads. Moving to Charleston, here's a look at 4 feet for Charleston, and it's quite a significant amount of flooding in the downtown area. Here's our plot of multi-year risk of flooding above 4 feet in a medium sea level rise scenario. Here's a single-year risk of flooding. Even with a fast rise, it's pretty low. And this is to highlight that all these projections I'm showing you, we're talking about flood risks that assume no change in climatology. We're only looking at how the flood risk is changing due to sea level rise. And as Jim could tell you, like, Charleston has seen probably like 3 higher than 4 foot flood events in the last couple of years. So in a lot of ways, these may be lowballing it. We're not taking into account any possible increase in storm energy along the coast that could be driving more floods. Because anyone who, you know, saw this lower risk for an annual flood like this might feel comfortable. This is much harder science, and it's much easier for us to talk about how the risk changes with sea level. The science of how storms will change and are changing with climate change, much harder to get a grip on, so we're simply not factoring those in. But the point is that you can get a lot more flooding than might be suggested by these annual risks. Here's a look at homes in South Carolina below that 4-foot level, tens of thousands of homes. And we've also been really gratified to see these tools get taken up by local stakeholders. The South Carolina Small Business Chamber of Commerce and the mayor of Beaufort helped to organize this kind of town hall meeting that was covered by NBC here. They used our maps. They formed a sea level rise task force.
Jim Gandy, WLTX in Columbia, South Carolina. Let me just comment about South Carolina. In South Carolina, it's a situation where the state has done nothing, or essentially nothing, and it's all left to the communities, and all of the communities are addressing sea level rise on their own. But they have come together to work with the South Carolina Sea Grant. And it's kind of interesting because while they're using what you're doing, they also have some other tools that they're using as well to look at projections, and they're all basically coming in line. Yeah. And up in North Carolina, if you're interested, Jessica Whitehead is the adaptation specialist in North Carolina in Raleigh. You might want to get together with her. But one of the things in South Carolina, all of the communities now have some sort of plan that they're working on, regardless of whether or not they believe in the human contribution to climate change or not, because sea level is reality.
Yeah. It's just a really practical thing, and people can see it. You know, you see the ghost forest, you see the floods. It's obviously a practical concern that can't be.
One thing, though, I do get comments on is what goes into making these projections? Yeah, because, you know, we can see the observational record. Okay, so how do we get from here into the future? What assumptions in the models are being made so that we make these projections?
So I would say that most projections now are proceeding, they're physical projections. They're based on models of different physical systems. So the first is a model of the ocean and sea surface temperatures and thermal expansion of the ocean. And I think we have the most confidence about that component, which I showed in the last several decades has been 40% of sea level rise. And we've been able to reconstruct what we've observed from the models, and we use the same class of models to make our forward projections of how sea level will rise from continued warming. So you have models of atmospheric warming, global warming, that translate to models of ocean warming, thermal expansion, and sea level rise from that component. Second component is glaciers. And there are models that track how, with warming temperatures, glaciers will respond. It's a relatively, while it was a big term at 30% in the last few decades, and it will stay a reasonable term for the rest of the century, and then it's nothing because they'll be gone. But those models, I think, are fairly straightforward as well. And then there are models for the ice sheets of Greenland and Antarctica. And that's where the most active research is going, and that's where the biggest question marks are. That's the difference between 1 meter by the end of the century or 2 meters by the end of the century. And it's just the physics is a lot harder. All right. So moving quickly to the Bay Area. Bay Area has another one of these two-decade transitions in this scenario, a fast rise scenario from 2030 to 2050. But we're looking at 3 feet, not such a big deal for San Francisco itself, the hilly city, a bigger deal for the Oakland Airport over on the side of this image. But that, I'm sure, can be protected with levees. Here's a look at how San Mateo has really got the most exposure in California. Boston. Boston is a really, really interesting case. We all talk about South Florida, but a lot of Boston is built on fill. Boston is extremely vulnerable, with Miami, I think, one of the major vulnerable American cities. And what's interesting here, you see everything is green. Everything is below, all of this area is below 4 feet, but protected. They're isolated. And you'll see that little red line up near Commercial Street, kind of the tip of Boston, Charles River Dam. So in this particular map, we gave the Charles River Dam credit for holding out the water. You know, that probably won't work for permanent sea level rise, but suppose a bigger structure is built there. We give it credit. But by the time you get to 5 feet, the water gets around that dam, and suddenly, boom. And it's just a huge area of Boston. Obviously, they can and will. I mean, Boston is looking very seriously at this question, as they should, because they have a lot of planning and engineering to do to safeguard Boston and Cambridge. It's interesting, I saw an article just last week or so. Boston has just come up with two different kind of resilience reports. And one basically said, we have this potential for sea level rise that's threatening all of these areas. We have to look at it closely. We have to defend wisely and so forth. The other said, yes, there could be a sea level risk, but the approach to handling that is we have to build more quickly and now in the most vulnerable places. And that will make us have to protect them later. I mean, even in Boston, a place you might think of as deep blue and thinking of, being very concerned about climate, like there's a big argument being pushed to say, no, ignore all that. Let's just build more and faster, even in the most vulnerable places, and we'll work it out later. So interesting to see those two lines of thoughts. So let's look at the risk for 5 feet. Risk of at least one flood exceeding 5 feet, medium scenario, not trivial over the next couple of decades and through mid-century. And it's higher with the fast rise. Single-year risk becomes, an annual event within half a century under fast rise. All right. Almost everything I've been showing you has been under the medium scenario, but the fast scenario corresponds to the closer, 2 meters of global sea level rise. The conservative consensus has been around 1 meter for this century, next 100 years. But new research on Antarctic ice sheet dynamics suggests we could be headed for 2 meters. And Jim did me the favor of, already going through some of that. So I will, this came out about a year ago in Nature. The big area of concern is West Antarctica. Here's a look at some of those glaciers, marine terminating glaciers, and the ice sheet behind them around the Amundsen Sea. Jim already explained how, when the water melts from underneath and then suddenly can start to run downhill below the ice sheet, we have an unstable situation. We've kind of pulled the cork out maybe from the bottle, and the ice is flowing out to the ocean. And he had nicer diagrams like this. And here's he showed this, but I've broken it out so you can see it a little bit more closely. These are figures from that paper. So the paper actually introduced two new mechanisms of ice sheet, that kind of speed ice sheet decay. And it's interesting to note that, this research is not the final word. It was a major new finding, very prominent by leading ice sheet scientists. There's going to be a lot more research, and some people will find lower sea level projections, and my ear to the ground says we're going to see some higher sea level rise projections as well in the next couple of years. But this paper was the first to accurately model sea level not only during the last interglacial warm period, but one 3 million years ago, where conditions were extremely different. No model had been able to do that until now. So there's a certain level of credibility here. And this paper says we could see 2 meters of sea level rise by the end of this century. So that's, double that typical 1 centimeter per year rate that Jim was talking about. One of the new mechanisms is you warm up the air enough and you get rain on the ice sheets of Antarctica and surface melt, and you get this hydrofracturing as meltwater percolates down into the ice shelf, which buttresses the ice sheet. The nice part about that is that's something that we actually can control on a relatively fast time scale, right? Atmospheric temperature. I'm not a proponent of geoengineering, but if someone did that, you could turn down the atmospheric temperature. Or if we stop emissions lower emissions very sharply, very quickly, we might prevent temperatures from ever reaching this threshold of significant surface melt on the ice shelves of Antarctica. So you lose ice shelf, and suddenly you're left with this unstable cliff face. And this is just a closer up look at what Jim was talking about. But once you get enough 100 meters, it's like your kid building blocks, building a tall tower of blocks. And if you've got buttresses around that tall tower, it won't fall. But if you take away the supports, it just collapses. And one thing you can notice about this picture is if that ice face, that unstable cliff face collapses, the cliff gets even taller, right? Because it's the natural condition. It's the way these ice sheets are. The downslope of the rock, the bedrock below, and the upslope on the thickness of the ice sheet moving inland. So this is an accelerating train, potentially. And West Antarctica is a place where we can currently there's a feeling in the community that studies West Antarctica that once it gets to a critical point, it could all fall apart in a few decades. And today we are measuring ice loss from West Antarctica in inches per century, but when we get to that point, it's going to be feet per decade, right? So it's a bomb with a very long fuse. We're not 100% sure that the fuse is lit, and we're not quite sure how fast the fuse will burn, but that's the structure, and it's kind of devilish for human psychology. One thing also to note about West Antarctica, and this is a little wonky, but ice sheets are big and massive enough that they exert a gravitational pull on water. So right now, water is attracted up toward the West Antarctic ice sheet in a little apron. And if you were to melt it all, that attraction would disappear. In fact, if you were to melt the West Antarctic ice sheet and get more than 10 feet of global sea level rise on average, sea level near West Antarctica would go down. Okay? And this graph shows that the blue here, sea level is going to go down. But anything in this map that's dark red, that's above 1, sea level is going to go up more than the global average. And once again, you see that North America wins this lottery. We are more vulnerable than average to the loss of West Antarctic ice because we're so far away from it. That ocean that, you know, West Antarctica not only does us the favor of holding water in its ice, but it also does us the favor of attracting the ocean toward it. And so when it melts, that attraction will go away, and we will get more than average sea level rise from that loss. All right, so some pictures of what that could look like. This is Highlands, New Jersey, with 6 feet of sea level rise. 3D image from Google Earth. 6 feet of sea level rise easily achievable in the scenarios outlined by that paper I was just describing. Now, the good news on that paper is if we curtail emissions very aggressively, kind of past the point where, you know, this is a little bit beyond credibility right now, but let's say we got there, we could hold things to 2 feet. Big difference. Here's Ocean City, New Jersey, at 6 feet. Here's Ocean City at 2 feet. Here's Camden, New Jersey, at 6 feet. At 2 feet. I gave a talk in New Jersey, and our offices are in New Jersey, so I had these New Jersey ones. And I'll take the New Jersey moment to just, yeah.
Just A quick question. This is Dave Jones with Storm Center. If you go back to that picture just real quick, like you see these little puddles on the corner, street corner. Is that just because sea level comes up through the storm drains, or?
No, this is it's a feature of kind of how Google Earth works.
Elevation.
So and this is just an elevation threshold, so it's a little depression there.
Gotcha. Great.
Yeah. These images are meant to be impressionistic as opposed to a precise forecast of, but I think the, there is truth in the impressions. I wouldn't use it as a planning tool, kind of block by block. New Jersey happens to have a huge amount of hazardous waste sites, EPA-listed sites, petrochemical sites, in low-lying, in total and also in low-lying areas around the coast. And so a flood is a good way to spread those kinds of chemicals around. We saw that with Katrina. We were really proud that a New Jersey news organization kind of took our data and made their own map and story. It was their own investigative journalism here. And this is just to underscore that there, we've told the tiniest fraction of stories that there are to tell from these maps and data and images. And I invite you and your colleagues and news colleagues to kind of explore more deeply for the places where you live. I'm just going to zip through here. This is just showing off some other graphics that we've done that are available. This is looking at 10 feet. 10 feet is a lot, but it's not sea level rise this century, but it is sea level rise plus a storm that we could see this century. So it's a foot higher than Sandy here. We could definitely see that this century here in Norfolk. A lot of people on land that low, obviously for Miami-Dade. It's most of the county. Galveston and so forth. So speaking of Galveston, okay, this is a photograph from after the hurricane in 1900 that struck Galveston, killed 2,000 people. So why did it kill 2,000 people? There was no warning, no warning at all. So a huge amount of investment has been made in the forecast community to be able to provide a warning. And you all understand very well that every extra day, every extra hour of warning a community can get about a serious incoming threat can save lives and it can save property. And we invest a tremendous amount to have the capability to give earlier, better warnings. I just showed you a bunch of stories about what could happen in the coming several decades, maybe a mortgage cycle or the whole coming century. How are we going to get people to pay attention to those timescales? Well, I would argue that sea level rise is like a hurricane. It's a slow-moving hurricane. The good part is it's slow. The bad part is it never leaves. Since it never leaves, the preparations have to be much more extensive. Where hours and days count for hurricanes, we need to see sea level decades ahead in order to prepare in ways that will be safe for communities and will minimize kind of economic losses, maybe maximize economic opportunities from the changes that we're going to have to make. But it's going to take decades. And that's this whole enterprise of both sea level science, but also communicating it. Because having great forecast technology does no good if you can't get it out to the people who need to hear it. And so the exact same thing is true with sea level. We're just talking about decades instead of hours and days. But I think you can understand that. It's the same idea. It's just a bigger impact on a slower timescale. And if you're not on the coast, here's a map of where refugees from Katrina went in the United States. Besides that, obviously almost all of our trade comes through our seaports. And our seaports are generally built on marginal land, marshland, infill, very low land on the coast. So I think our seaports are going to have a lot of struggle with this issue.
While we're on the topic of forecasts and warnings, I just wanted to share this prototype that we did. When Matthew was coming, we took a storm surge forecast, we put it in our Google Earth 3D environment, we took a look at what Jacksonville, downtown Jacksonville, could look like in one of the kind of NOAA-sponsored forecasts, and we put it on social media. And this got 265,000 organic views, mostly, you know, overwhelmingly, you know, positive comments. And I'd be really interested in feedback from this group about whether this kind of tool, this is not what we do normally, but we realize that our visualization technology might be really useful in, you know, a hurricane situation, an urgent situation, in showing people what a big storm surge really could look like in their communities. All right, finally on to forever. So sea level rise is not forever. What will go up can go down. As Jim showed, we've had these cycles over time. But those cycles take so long that as far as human civilization and human history is concerned, what I'm going to show really is about forever and our legacy and our cities. I'm going to try and zip through a few of these, but I guess the main point is we have, there's a body of research that gives us more confidence in making a relationship between carbon dioxide emissions and warming and how much sea level rise we will get eventually in the long run. We have more confidence between the relationship between warming and long-term sea level rise than we have in understanding how quickly sea level will rise. And to understand why that's easy, imagine I had a block of ice. You know, I took a shovel full of, dumped a pile of snow in the middle of this room. Like, we would all know with certainty that it's all going to melt. That's very easy to say. It's much harder to say, you know, how many ounces are melting per minute, right? We'd have to do a lot of analysis to figure that out. So I'm going to show you now, it's not the how many ounces per minute, but how much sea level rise could we see in the long term based on different levels of warming. And it underscores the choice that we have around, you know, how many emissions, how much carbon dioxide are we going to put in the atmosphere, and what are we going to leave? What's our legacy to future generations? What I'm going to show you could take hundreds of years to unfold. It might be 100 or 200, or more. Yeah, I'd say between 200 and 2,000, and probably closer to 200 years. I'll also say that the science that this is based on, it's appeared in top journals, but also it's on the low end. Okay, it's more like 2 meters per degree Celsius, as opposed to 20 meters per degree Celsius. So we're not looking at the super long term. We're just looking at the next couple centuries, couple millennia. So here's 2 meters per degree Celsius, more papers. I'm going to skip over this. An interesting thing just to say is that in terms of locking in long-term sea level, this is the relationship between the volume of gasoline you combust and the volume of that's added to the ocean in the long term. Right? Insulating, it's so powerful to put an insulating blanket around the Earth and increase its thickness, because we're harnessing the energy of the sun every single day, right? We could detonate, you've probably all heard the things about how many Hiroshima bombs were detonating per day in terms of the energy added, right? We could never add that kind of energy to the atmosphere ocean system ourselves by lighting fires, burning fossil fuels, but we're just harnessing the sun, and once you put the carbon dioxide up there, it's trapping that energy for tens, hundreds, and thousands of years, and so you get this huge ratio, huge contribution to ocean volume. This is the last time I'll be able to give a talk and brag that the sitting president of the United States has cited my group's research. Actually, I hope it won't be the last, but it's the last for a while anyway. We'll see how things go. Here's a look at the relationship between temperature and sea level, locked in long-term sea level. So Jim asked, how big a deal is 1 degree Celsius? There's 1 degree Celsius. long-term sea level rise. So South Florida is long gone. And then we continue, here's 2 degrees Celsius. Yeah. So look at Louisiana in the corner there. Exactly. Half a degree for Louisiana, 1 degree. Right? This is stuff that's in the pipeline. It's in the pipeline. But we have a choice between, we're missing 2 degrees in this. 4 degrees. Okay. And we're on the 4 degree path right now. Map simple enough that Leo DiCaprio feels that it's good for his audience. Here's another way to look at it, a kind of A-B choice. Here's Boston after 4 degrees versus 2 degrees in the different panels. Not so good with 2 degrees. Other places have a bigger choice. Here's Manhattan, 4 degrees, 2 degrees. Here's DC, 4 degrees, 2 degrees. 2 degrees actually maybe manageable with some levees. Here's a look at Wilmington, North Carolina area. Charleston. I actually took this one down to 1.5 degrees so that there's some non-blue showing.
Ben?
Yeah.
Quick question. When we talk about the temperature anomalies of going from 1 degree or 2 degrees or 1.5, aren't we right now at 1.5 degrees? Or where are we? Is it
0.8? We're close to 1.5. Yes, we're close. In the last year, we actually got above it for a couple months, 1.5 degrees above. In February, we were 1.5 degrees above the pre-industrial February. Overall, I mean, it was a hot year, so I'd say factoring out El Nino, you know, maybe we're at 1.2, 1.3. But yeah, 1.5 is pretty much out of reach.
So the question that I have is, when you show a graphic of flooding and you say 1.5 degrees, and we're only a couple of tenths away from that,
Yeah. Is
there a lag time? So when people, because what I'm concerned about is,
yes,
that we say, hey, this is what it's going to look like at 1.5 degrees, and then we're at 1.5 degrees, and everybody says, well, I'm riding my bike along the coastline.
Yes.
Right?
The lag time is that 200 to 2,000-year period.
Gotcha.
And I think, I mean, the recent science says 200, not 2,000. Recent science says it's coming sooner.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. In fact, you know, some of these, the levels here for 1.5, if I think about it, you know, there's some stuff. Yeah, I mean, in some scenarios, it could be 100. So 4 degrees, but in those cases, when we get there that fast, we're also going to blow right past these levels to much higher levels. And in that, all of these things I'm showing you are actually, I have to admit, like almost embarrassingly conservative. But we try and focus on the nearer term and not something that's just impossible to look at.
Well, and I think also I was on a science committee for the Hampton Roads Sea Level Rise Committee, and you know, everybody's asking for numbers, right? They want in 2030, what's it going to be?
Yeah.
A foot, 2 feet, and you know, it's very hard to quantify. So I think these graphics are great. I think it's important to tell the right, you know, story in the context of, you know, not really alerting people that they need to panic right now, but this is what it could look like in so many number of years.
This is the choice of our legacy, right? In our culture, right, we remember the founding fathers. That is an important part of our history. That's part of our culture today. And that was 250 years ago. And the world could look like these pictures in 250 years. So what will those people think about us and our choices? That's what we're talking about here. I mean, the three chapters of this talk, the today, tomorrow, and forever. Today was about inches, tomorrow is about feet, and forever is about tens of feet. And also takes, you know, we also went from the present to looking at the next few decades to looking at the next few centuries. But
before we dismiss the next few centuries, the point is that we lock it in now, because once carbon is in the atmosphere, its effects last for hundreds and thousands of years. So this is what we are. We are unique in human history, actually. I mean, we have a unique responsibility and privilege. I don't believe there has ever been a generation that self-consciously understood that it would be shaping the face of the Earth, civilization, and history for the next 10,000 years. Because I'm a co-author on a paper where we took these maps out 10,000 years, and it looks much worse. But the point is, those simulations, we all assumed that we were finished polluting by the year 2200. No more carbon dioxide goes into the atmosphere. So we looked at different scenarios for this century. We keep on going up, and then we turn it around starting 2100. Or we get things under control more quickly and go to zero by 2200. After that kind of geological blip for 200 years, we play the tape for 10,000 years. And the sea level keeps rising, and you know, we are creating the planet for the next 10,000 years. That's more than all of the history of human civilization, and we know it. So we have the opportunity with our minds to look into the future and to plan and to do something different. We have the opportunity to make that a better next 10,000 years. We have the opportunity also to drown our coasts and do a lot more over those next 10,000 years. I mean, whoever has known that, like, as a generation of people? I mean, it's a very heavy responsibility. It's also an awesome opportunity. And I wouldn't underestimate the speed at which the ice sheets could fall apart. I also wouldn't underestimate the speed at which technology and economies can transform, right? When you hit the right point, and the price of the new technology is low enough, and the conditions are right, right? I mean, fracking turned the U.S. energy system upside down in a few years. No one ever heard of it. Suddenly, everything was natural gas and fracking. Now, I'm not saying fracking is a good thing or a bad thing. I'm just observing that we went from something we never heard of to something dominating the energy system in a decade. So change can happen fast. Portland, Oregon is not exempt. Shanghai is not exempt. And we took some of these and made them into photorealistic images. So I'll conclude just by giving this kind of most photorealistic visual sense of this legacy choice in front of us. So here is the 4 degrees C business as usual future of Shanghai, kind of the illustrated sea level. Here's 2 degrees, meeting the targets of the Paris Agreement. Here is the gateway to India in Mumbai, 4 degrees. Here's 2 degrees. All of this is based on peer-reviewed science that we have rigorously checked the elevations in these images as we developed them. Here's our choice for London. 4 degrees, 2 degrees. Not very good at 2 degrees. Here's the Sydney Opera House, 4 degrees. I wouldn't be having a picnic if the water were quite that high. The Googleplex, 4 degrees, Silicon Valley, 2 degrees. Miami Beach, 4 degrees. Okay. Sure thing.
Which building is yours? It's not as hard to do a screen grab.
You know what? I have all the files. You can download them. Yeah. So that's 4 degrees. Here comes 2 degrees.
Ben.
Yeah.
Steve Weigel, WPTV in West Palm Beach, just up the road from John. And Craig, you mentioned earlier the $400 million that is going toward Miami Beach. We also have some money going into some of our coastal areas. Is that wasted money? Like, are we kind of throwing, you know, that seawalls and humps, draining systems?
It's a great question. My feeling is probably not. Let me give you a metaphor that I've used. I've been on the radio and on the kind of peak news, the number one news station in the Keys, right, in the morning rush hour. And they asked me, like, you know, what's the future of the Keys? Are we here or are we gone? And there was nothing that I could say except the Keys will be gone. I mean, there is just no way that the Keys will survive. But does that mean we all pick up and go right now? No. Think about a human life. Like, we all die. We know that. So do we throw in the towel today knowing that? No. Like, we have a meaningful life to live. So even places that we know beyond a shadow of a doubt don't have a long-term future with the sea level rise that's coming. And I would go beyond the Keys to say South Florida in general. That is true. They still have a very meaningful life to live. And there are different courses of medication that might prolong that life to some degree and prolong the cultural contribution and perhaps in buying time make it easier to come up with the plan to eventually relocate and perhaps do that in such a model way as to serve as an example for the world and provide a very meaningful service for other communities.
Also, just one other quick question. If you, this is more personal opinion, if you lived in South Florida 8 feet above sea level in an oceanfront home, would you sell it?
Yes. Well, let me just say this. On the day after Thanksgiving, there was an article in the New York Times about research being done by a kind of real estate company, and they looked at sales in South Florida. Zip code by zip code. And by and large, the zip codes that had the highest rates of flooding took longer to sell a property. So even though there's still new development pouring into South Florida, there are already some signals in the market that suggest that the nuisance flooding and the forecasts are starting to have an effect. So,
and the insurance issues too.
Yeah. John.
John Morales from NBC6 in Miami. So, you know, because I talk so much about climate change and sea level rise, I also moderate a lot of panels down there on this subject. And I was on a panel once, and one of the panelists was the mayor of Miami Beach, Mayor Levine. And of course, he likes to take credit for the pumps, even though they were started in a previous administration. But of course, that's par for the course, right? But one of the things I asked him, I said, well, I mean, you realize that this is a Band-Aid, right? I mean, for now, you're being able to pump all this water out. I won't even go into what's in that water that's being pumped back into Biscayne Bay, because that's a big problem. And the city of Miami Beach likes to refute that, and then they attack the scientists that are talking about all the junk that's going back into Biscayne Bay. But anyway, we can talk about that later. The bottom line is that then I asked him, well, if it's a Band-Aid, you know, what about the long-term future of Miami Beach? And his response was, you know, I believe in human ingenuity, and a solution will be found. So basically, he's trusting that some geoengineering solution is going to be found for this problem down the road. I mean, I just wanted to comment on that. Regarding that New York Times article, I did see that. You know, it's interesting. It's a conundrum down there. What goes on is the city of Miami Beach and other coastal communities like Fort Lauderdale, they need the tax base and they need a larger property tax base to be able to complete some of these projects, like the $400 million being spent on the pumps. So they continue to approve all these projects, which eventually will be in peril due to sea level rise. But I think it's going to happen, like Jim White said, it's going to happen in a nonlinear fashion. There's going to be some type of initial domino that's going to lead to several others, and it's going to get ugly at some point.
Yeah, I think, unfortunately, that's the most likely scenario. One thing I sometimes say also in response to the earlier question is, look, we know how where the system is moving. So at some point, this problem is going to be glaringly obvious to everyone in the world. It's going to be glaringly obvious to everyone in South Florida, right? Would you like to understand this before that happens or after that happens, right? And I think that The answer is before. Now, when, as a society, we really grasp these hard truths, it's going to cause some shocks. It's going to cause shocks to the market. It's going to be really difficult for people. My firm conviction is that the longer the warning we give, right, the smaller those shocks will be. If the awareness happens 50 years before an untenable situation, it's a much smaller shock than if it happens 20 years before an untenable situation, right? Because people will see, even though they know the place is doomed, there's still economic use and rent to be had over the next 20, 30, 40 years. Even though we know the economics are a bit different than a normal place, there's still value, and let's work this out. But if the shock is that one day we wake up and we see some giant chunk just fell off the wrong ice sheet in West Antarctica, and you know, we see that we're now in the feet per decade era, that's too late. Like then you have a really major shock that will be so disruptive to very many.
Jim? Yeah. Jim Gandy, WLTX in Columbia, South Carolina. You showed some pictures there of Shanghai, of Mumbai, and other places internationally. What has been the international reaction?
So I guess on one level, the international reaction was partly expressed in the Paris agreements that happened a year ago, when for the first time ever, every nation in the world essentially got together and said, we own a part of this responsibility. We are going to do part of the work. Right? The last time all the nations got together to talk about climate change in a big way in Copenhagen, there was a sense that the rich nations should cut their emissions and the poor nations were too poor to worry about it. They hadn't caused the problem so much yet. And now there's a recognition that this is such a large problem and we're all in it. Everyone has to make a contribution. I can also say specifically, we happened to release these images in conjunction with that paper a month before COP21 in Paris. And we had a huge, huge uptake, more than 5,000 stories globally. It was on TV everywhere. It was in the Borneo Times. It was in the top 10 outlets in China and India and Australia and in 7 to 10 of the top 10 outlets. So there's a lot of attention globally. Yeah. Here's the Pentagon, 2 degrees. And here's Wall Street in the bull. Yeah.
Todd Santos from CBS Buffalo. Just a question. I know I don't want to go too far off your topic. First, I like the idea of living in the lost city of Atlantis until it becomes the lost city of. I appreciate that with the Florida Keys analogy. You've looked a lot at rising ocean versus land interaction because it impacts us so much. Have you looked at all, I mean, it's almost unavoidable to decouple ocean, rising sea level and ocean interaction with the ocean and currents, transport currents and that sort of thing. Hmm. Is there anything in there that shows up in the research you've done here that is kind of an alarming, kind of yeah. something that touches off a bell and says, ooh, that's concerning, Gulf Stream, that sort of
right.
thing?
Right. So short answer to that is an interesting question. No, we haven't looked at that. There is a Gulf Stream story, but it's not around sea level rise. It is a little connected, though, with the melting of the Greenland ice sheet, because as that
the fresh water
cold fresh water enters, it could shut down, or slower shut down the conveyor belt. Yeah. And since you're from Buffalo, my last slide, I'll just, it's not sea level at all, but just Bernadette, my friend and colleague Bernadette Plackey, who I know many of you know, said, oh, you got to get that one in. Al Roker does it too, using some of our materials. And, you know, it's hot out there, and when it's hot, the ice melts. So here are some websites where you can find everything, almost everything I showed you, free to use, online. Feel free to contact me or Bernadette, and we can point you to anything that might be useful. So,
Ben, thank you very much. This is terrific.
Thank you.